The title of this sermon, which is not printed in your program, is No Greater Love, and in parentheses, or Not Your Kind of People. No Greater Love, or Not Your Kind of People. Now, the language Not Your Kind of People comes from a song that I've been listening to a lot recently. It's on the new Garbage album. I'm guessing most of you are not familiar with Garbage. Not the best name for a rock band, but nevertheless, an enormously successful rock band. They were kind of in they came out sort of in the middle 1990s. One of their members, Butch Vig, was one of the producers of some of the great grunge bands from the early 1990s. Some of you will have heard of Nirvana. That was Butch Biggs. So this band is very well connected and very successful in their own right. They just put out their fifth album called Not Your Kind of People. So I just want to play a couple seconds of the song Not Your Kind of People, because it really gets right at what I want to say today in this sermon. So just for your listening pleasure, Garbage. Oops, I didn't turn up the volume. No. We'll start again. That was not a technical difficulty, that was just my mistake. Here we go. Maybe not, Jane. I'm playing. Now that's a technical difficulty. No, it's blasting. Nah. That might work. Well, you know what? I'm not going to belabor this. It's a beautiful song. If we get it one more time, this worked at the first service. Pays to get up early. Doesn't matter. Shirley Manson's the lead singer. She says, "We are not your kind of people. You seem kind of phony. Everything's a lie. We are not your kind of people. Something in your makeup don't see eye to eye. We are not your kind of people. Don't want to be like you ever in our lives. We are not your kind of people. Speak a different language. We see through your lies. We are not your kind of people. We won't be cast as demons, creatures you despise." Now, I don't know if the band intends to convey a specific meaning with these lyrics or if they're describing a specific situation. It's not clear. I assume at some level they want their audience to find their own meaning and apply it to their own situation. Although the music, which you didn't hear, is gentle, especially for Garbage. The lyrics convey a strong, even harsh sentiment. We are not your kind of people broadcasts a feeling of disconnection, separation, alienation, a feeling even of brokenness in the human family. It's akin, or at least similar to the feeling, a mixed feeling to be sure, that arose in me when I watched this film, No Greater Love, a 2009 Lionsgate and Thomas Nelson film. Thomas Nelson, for those of you who aren't familiar, is the world's largest Christian book publisher and is Lionsgate's exclusive distributor to the Christian entertainment markets. I don't normally watch films like this. Alan and Kathy Ayers suggested it to me as a background for this sermon, again, which they purchased at last year's goods and services auction. Alan and Kathy wouldn't normally watch films like this either. They watched it thinking it was something else. That is, they rented it by accident. But who hasn't done that? Who hasn't done that? So again, here's the storyline, a little more detail. In a haze of alcohol and drug use, a young woman, Heather, walks out on her marriage and newborn baby due to her depression, and she just disappears. 10 years later, her ex-husband, Jeff, who she'd known since childhood, they'd been childhood sweethearts, elementary school sweethearts, even, Jeff accidentally runs into Heather again when he sends his son to a summer Bible camp where he is working. Jeff and his son aren't part of the church. They have friends who are part of the church, and the friends invited them. He said, okay, whatever. So they start getting to know each other again, Jeff and Heather. And it turns out that during those 10 years of separation, Heather has become an evangelical Christian. She's been born again. She's been saved in the traditional sense. Jeff, who is not religious in any sense, realizes that he is still in love with Heather, and he calls off his engagement to another woman. But Heather's minister, Chris, tells Jeff they can't be together because he is a non-believer. That's when the not your kind of people feeling started arising in me. This upsets Jeff, but then he reveals that he never actually executed the divorce papers. He and Heather are still legally married. Now, Pastor Chris tells them they have to stay together based on their church's interpretation of biblical law. Under any circumstances, marriage is better than divorce. Now, we can assume they wouldn't apply this standard to same-sex marriage or in the event one partner had sexual reassignment surgery. That would be a very, very different movie. Heather is concerned that her unbelieving husband won't allow her to practice her Christian faith. Jeff is concerned that Heather is now only staying in the marriage because the Bible and her pastor demand it. Are you following this so far? I suspect most people can watch this film, and no matter what spiritual or religious belief they profess, they can get caught up in the romantic plot and really root for Jeff and Heather to be in love and to be together no matter what. I certainly wanted a happy ending. I like the big happy endings. I'm a sucker for the, you know, the feel good happy ending. I think what I'm reacting to and what Alan and Kathy are reacting to, at least on the surface, is the role of the pastor and church law and what appears to be Heather's inability to think for herself beyond trying to fit herself into the framework her church and the Bible demand, at least as she understands those demands. And right there is the border between liberal religious people and conservative religious people. And there are many ways to describe this border, but in this case, the conservative religious person looks to some external authority, the Bible, the Ten Commandments, church law, the minister, a transcendent God, and the liberal religious person looks to some internal authority, conscience, reason, personal experience, the still small voice in me, as we just sang, that place inside where we know our truth, an immanent God, if one believes in God, an inner sense of the divine. In this case, the conservative religious person assumes the situation is black and white, that a definitive, correct answer exists and can be found through a careful reading of scripture or church law. And the minister in this situation is regarded as the expert in these matters, or at least should be the expert. The liberal religious person encounters a whole lot of gray in this situation, and will search through that gray looking not for the right answer, because the liberal religious person is not sure there is a right answer. They're looking for what is hopefully the best answer given all the nuances of the situation. The liberal minister's job is to help the individual discern their best answer. These differences are much more complex than I've just described them. It's not a clean line. There are liberals who would identify more on the side I've described as conservative, and conservatives who I'd identify more on the side I've described as liberal. However, the differences are real, and because of them, liberal religious people typically experience conservative religious people as unthinking and irrational. Conservative religious people typically experience liberal religious people as not actually religious, as non-believers, postmodern, relativistic, and as some of us have recently heard, rudderless. There's a border here. There's a border here. And remember, borders is our ministry theme for June. It's a border that cuts through countries, states, towns, cities, neighborhoods, workplaces, schools, and families. From the perspective on either side of that border, it is quite possible to feel that we are not your kind of people. So Kathy and Alan asked me to preach on how, as Unitarian Universalists, as liberal religious people, we can best relate to people like Heather and her minister when we encounter them. How can we relate to people who live on the other side of this border from us? How can we respect beliefs that at times seem illogical or irrational to us? How do we accept people who hold those beliefs? How can we resist the temptation to judge? And even in suggesting these kinds of questions, Kathy said she felt she was coming across as arrogant, but said it seemed like the same kind of arrogance she feels conservative religious people direct at her liberal religious identity. So there's a border. And that's the question. How do we relate across the religious border? I'm pretty sure the capacity to relate across the religious border that I've been describing and across many of the borders that divide people from people doesn't come to us naturally. It doesn't come to us naturally. It takes practice. It requires patience. And I think we acquire it through a developmental process. And I don't want to go into the stages of faith development, but I'll say it like this. I think there's often a beginning point in one's faith life where one is very excited about their faith, especially if it's newfound. One is very proud of their faith. One even feels special because of their faith. That's a starting place, and we develop to a deeper place of humility. A recognition that our faith is one of many, that there is room within a family, a neighborhood, a workplace, a school, a town, a city, a state, a nation, a planet for many faiths. And none is set above, none is set below, none is set apart as somehow more special, more important. It's a movement from pride to humility. That's the development I'm looking for, one of pride, and I'm not talking about an unhealthy kind of pride. I'm talking about a healthy pride. I like my faith, and it's not a pride I want to lose, but I want to move towards a greater sense of humility. The film, No Greater Love, does not reach that humble place, and that's not the reason it was made. The proof for me is in the title, No Greater Love. There's certainly a romantic meeting which has to do with how Jeff and Heather feel about each other and how it twists a little bit at the end, which I'm not going to tell you just in case you're going to go out and see it. But then there's the biblical meaning. I read to you the Bible verse that contains this phrase from John 15:13. There is no greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And in the film, nobody lays down their life for their friends. Nobody contemplates that. That's not what the film is about. So it seems at first like a bad title, but if you read the next few verses, it becomes clear why this title might make sense. So this is a little beyond John 15:13. Jesus says, "No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." He's talking to his disciples. Then he says, "You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing, but I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you." I chose you. "And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name." So in my experience, this is one of those biblical passages often used to justify an attitude of Christian exceptionalism. Jesus says, "I chose you. I didn't choose everyone. I chose you." It's not always used to justify Christian exceptionalism, but it can be used, and it has been used. It's not a universalistic statement. It's not universalism, it's exceptionalism. And all through the film, although the characters don't use the language of chosenness, they say it in many ways. We're different, we're special, we're exceptional. There's something about us that sets us apart from other people. Can't you see it? And if you watch the way the film is done, you know, when they're saying these kinds of phrases, which on one level seem very innocuous, the light kind of shines in the back of their face. You can see see the glow in their eye. See if it works. You know, you get it, you be, it, this sort of beatific thing going on. It's you know, it's filmmaking. It's manipulative. I would probably do the same thing if I were making a film about Unitarian Universalism. But Jeff, the unbeliever who wants to be with the believing Heather, begins to see the difference through the course of the movie. He sees that Heather's faith has helped her resolve the problems that led her to leave him in the first place, and he admires it. And he says, by the end of the movie, I want what you have. I want what you have. Well, don't get me wrong. There's nothing wrong with a movie studio making a movie like this. And there's nothing wrong with people being excited about their faith, proud of their faith, or feeling special because of their faith. But let's be clear, humility is a sign of a deeper level of faith, and this is not humility. This film sets Christians, and it's a very specific kind of Christians at that, it sets apart and above other people. Despite its pleasant romantic vibe, it contributes to a strengthening of the religious border by proclaiming, we are not your kind of people, we're different, we're special. And that's why liberal religious people, including liberal Christians, might react negatively or might feel that border in their lives. Now, to emphasize this last point, let me be clear. I am not suggesting that religious exceptionalism is somehow unique to religious conservatives. We religious liberals have our own version of it. It's perhaps more subtle at times than the religious conservative version because the language we typically use to describe our liberal faith expresses an openness to other religions and embrace of religious pluralism. Our Unitarian and Universalist roots remind us, if anything, that all are chosen, not some, all are chosen. All are welcome, all matter, all possess inherent worth and dignity, regardless of who they are, what they believe, who they love, or how they live. Well, I think this is beautiful. It's exciting. It fills me with pride. It makes me feel special. But I'm also aware the line between pride and humility can be thin at times. And if I'm not vigilant, I can very easily fall into the place of assuming my faith is the more enlightened faith. My faith sets me apart. My faith is forged in the crucible of my life experience, my intuition, my reasoning mind, not a set of ancient books that tell an exaggerated, if not false, history of the ancient Near East and promote a patriarchal culture whose values run completely counter to modern democratic principles. No, no. My faith emerges from the story of my life, from that place inside of me where my truth resides, where I discern and connect to the sacred, not from a church doctrine designed to control the people, to wage a war on women, to make sexual minorities invisible by preventing them from attaining full legal status, or from promoting holy war against perceived infidels. Can I get an amen? Do not respond. Hold back. Hold on. I got to... just to be sure. Can you hear it? I absolutely believe the sentences I just uttered are true. They express who I am. They express my social, political, and spiritual commitments. But let's be honest, they can be heard, and they were stated as an expression of liberal religious exceptionalism. This is primarily because of the words I chose to use. I emphasized who I am not as much as who I am. I said not in a set of ancient books and then spoke about those ancient books in a condescending way. I can speak about those ancient books in a way that shows that I love them dearly. I said not from a church doctrine and then implied that church doctrine is responsible for a whole host of social evils, knowing full well that it's not often church doctrine so much as it is people striving for power and feeling afraid inside and needing to exploit and oppress others out of that place of fear and not knowing. I built my faith up while tearing the faith of others down. It's divisive language. It's fighting language. It's us versus them language. It's exceptionalist language. I won't say that it is empty rhetoric, but it is cheap rhetoric. It's easy I like to think I'm real good at it. And if I'm honest, there is something satisfying about it, but it's not humble and it's not effective if the goal is to relate well across the religious border. So I think meeting the challenge of relating well across the religious border does not in any way require us to change our liberal religious values. It doesn't require anyone to change their religious values. It does not require us or anyone to moderate our excitement about our faith tradition or our pride in it or the way it makes us feel special and also grounded and also whole. But the first step towards spiritual humility at the border is speaking our truth without putting others down. I could just as easily have said, my faith emerges from the crucible of my life experience, my intuition, my reasoning mind. It is consistent with modern democratic principles, freedom, liberty, human rights. My faith emerges from the story of my life, from the place inside me where my truth resides, where I discern and connect to what is sacred for me. It leads me to support reproductive rights for women and families, equal pay for equal work, civil rights for gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender people. It leads me to reject war and other forms of violence as methods for resolving conflict. It's the very same statement. It just hasn't intentionally created an us and a them. It says who I am. It doesn't rely on who I am not. It doesn't criticize who I am not. It's a big difference. But even more important than this, I think for humility, is our capacity to bring curiosity to the border, to bring a genuine desire to learn about people who live across the border and to become well-versed in the religious ways of the world. Curiosity does not necessarily change who we are, but it does challenge us to clarify and deepen who we are. I think it would have been a very different film if Jeff had said, the character of Jeff, and he would have seemed more real and authentic to me, if he said, wow, Heather really believes the Bible is true. She really takes her church and what her minister says seriously. She strives to conduct her life in response to all of that. So what's true for me? Where do my truths come from? What truth does my life respond to? That would have been a more authentic response in my view. Learning another's faith enables us to become more of who we are, not less. The curiosity is not only about the person on the other side, it's about ourselves and what that other person's faith says to us about ourselves or what it inspires in us to learn about ourselves. Learning another's faith challenges us to clarify and deepen our own faith. It challenges us to become more mature in our faith, and it calls us to humility as we approach the borders of our lives. I suspect it is true. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends or one's family. But in an age when we are so prone to exceptionalism, often without even realizing it,